came from a creative family. What was your first kind of inspiration that kind of directed you where you wanted to go?
Well, my mother played the piano. Right. I really wish I'd learned to play the piano, but I was too busy playing football or something, or climbing trees, you know, in the country. One of my first musical memories is dressing up when I was about six, dressing up like one of these music hall characters. There was two guys called Flanagan and Allen.
Okay.
They used to sing a song called Underneath the Arches.
Right.
You know, they were a couple of tramps. And my brother and I dressed up as these two tramps when I was about six, you know, and sang Underneath the Arches. That was one of my first musical memories, really. So my mother played the piano, everybody did a turn, you know. My auntie was an actress, and she used to recite Shakespeare, and I think I remember my dad reciting The Ancient Mariner or something like that by Coleridge, you know.
Very broad,
yeah, very broad, sort of, you know, creative. My grandfather used to make movies, and he had his sort of theatrical troops that he used to take around, like the working men's clubs and places like that.
You had a stint in the Merchant Navy after you had done that engineering course, and you had a
Royal Navy, in the Merchant Navy.
Merchant Navy.
Yeah.
And then you traveled Europe and you became part of a musical circus.
Well, I was a part of, I got involved in a thing in Holland, which was a sort of rock and roll circus. But I was just working in it, I wasn't playing music in it. I was a roustabout. I was putting a tent up every day. This tent that held about 3,000 people, you know, 9 poles. It was fucking huge, you know. And it's enormous, and there's 3 or 4, 4 or 5 of us put it up every day. We'd sort of arrive at the venue, put the tent up at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, do a show with all these bands that used to come from Amsterdam. All the sort of current pop bands, really, psychedelic bands and stuff like that. They'd all perform. I'd work in the bar and give out flowers. There's all flower power, you know. When it finished, we'd take the tent down. And this is in the middle of the night, you know. We'd pack it away on this big articulated lorry, and then we'd get in all these vehicles and tow all these trailers to the next venue and get in the back of the caravan and go to sleep for a few hours. Then be woken up and have to put the thing up again. We did that every day. I did that for about 3 months. You know, it was awesome, you know.
Was much money in it?
Not really. No, we had enough to keep a little bit of money, you know. We have to buy what we needed.
Of course.
Sort of thing. It's quite cool.
Big influence on your direction, though, and opened your eyes to it.
Well, I was sort of always into music, and then at this point I met Mick Slattery, the guitarist for this band.
Uh-huh.
And Dave Brock, who was a guitarist in Hawkwind,
they were
playing in a band that came and played at this circus, at this rock and roll circus thing. And then I just kept in touch with them after that. You know, they went back to England. I just maintained contact with them. I used to go and stay with Dave in London and hang out in London with him and Mick. And then I got involved with them in Hawkwind. So, you know, it had a sort of a knock-on effect.
Domino effect. The history between Dave Brock and a lot of people.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I don't really have much to say about him, really. I think he's very sad. I feel sorry for him, really. I did one tour with him in 1984, and he said, "Oh, I'm really glad you're on the tour." I said, "Oh, why is that?" He said, "Well, I've got somebody to talk to. I don't like anybody. Nobody likes me. And I can talk to you, and like we're friends, and blah blah, you know, we've been friends for a long time." I said, "Okay, yeah, great, you know, happy to be here."
Absolutely.
And then he engineered me getting the sack again.
I know, yeah.
It's all sort of control freakery, really, which is very sad, you know. Hawkwind used to be a really communal band where everybody that was in it thought they were part of the band until they got the sack. You know, Dave sacked them, and Dave used to manipulate the situation. You know, it's sort of divide and rule, really, type of thing, you know, so it's very sad. And then ultimately I had this band, which I called X Hawkwind, and then he sued me. And because he trademarked the name of Hawkwind, I thought it was a Hawkwind band. You know, I thought it was even the Punters band.
Yeah.
I know the people that came to it. I thought it was everybody's band that ever had anything to do with it, that ever put any energy into it. I mean, you know, if only Hawkwind was a band like Gong. It's all so inclusive.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's not all greedy and fucking, you know, exclusive. And it's just like, you know, David Allen started Gong, and and they're all really nice people. I've known them for years. Uh-huh. And I get on really well with them, and Steve and Niket and, you know, Jilly. Done albums with all of them.
Yeah. I was talking to Steve Hillage earlier on, well, and I mentioned to him when you took your time in Egypt,
yeah,
and you recorded inside the pyramids.
The Great Pyramid, you know.
That's right. Yeah. Well, that must have been pretty...
That was quite awesome, yeah. Uh-huh. I mean, it was just a spur of the moment thing I did. I just went to Egypt for a holiday. A mate of mine was working as a catering manager on the oil rigs, and he said, "Oh, come out to Cairo for Christmas." You know, I just did the recording for myself, and then when I came back to England, I just left Hawkwind at the time. When I came back to England, I suddenly realised I had a recording contract to fulfil. So I went to see the guy who owned the record company and said, "Look, I've got these recordings I did inside the Great Pyramid, and I've got this great idea to turn it into an album." I as a theme for the music, I thought about the Egyptian Book of the Dead and all the Egyptian gods, and then I envisaged somebody coming in, going into the pyramid on Venus, say. There's a pyramid on Venus, you know, like that one.
Right.
And then sort of meeting all these guys who operate the pyramid, and they're actually the Egyptian gods. You know, I met Osiris and Isis and Horus and Nephthys and Anubis and Thoth. You know, and they were all the crew of this interdimensional sort of spaceship, and I met all those people, and then we passed through, you know, which is what the sort of Egyptian Book of the Dead is all about. It's like an initiation, really. And then he found himself, he sort of went out of the pyramid and found himself in Egypt in 1977. And while I was there, I was also hanging out with all these Bedouins, and they took me into the desert, and they had these fantastic horses. And this guy was a real horse fanatic, the guy that ran the record label, Tony Stratton Smith. He had all race horses himself. And I had all these photographs of all these fantastic Arab horses dancing, you know, in time with the music and shit like that. All these big bands playing all these pipes and drums, you know, making all this really raucous noise. You know, it was at an engagement party of this really sort of high-class, extremely rich Bedouin family that I got taken to by these people that I met. You know, they owned all the shops around the pyramids, but they sort of took me under their wing, because I'd go around playing my flute everywhere I went, you know, on a bus in a taxi. You know, they have taxis. You get a taxi, they'll take the taxi, go all over town, dropping people at different places. And I got in a taxi one day, I was playing my flute, and there's this guy sitting next to me, and he said, "Oh, Johnny King." Well, I said, "Oh, okay, who are you?" He said, "Oh, I'm the director of the Cairo Radio Orchestra. You know, come back to my house and have a play, and I'll give you a job in the orchestra if you want."
Did you take him up?
I never did. So I went back to his house and had a play, and he gave me a meal. Oh. I didn't have time to sort of, you know, get involved in that sort of thing. I mean, I would like to have done. But I mean, I had the offer, which was very nice.
You know, being out there and taking into the culture and stuff, you know, that must be something that fascinated you.
Yeah.
You know, about the culture. And the
I thought it was fantastic. I was just sort of awestruck by everything I saw. You know, you see these statues, you see a head that's 10 foot high, beautifully carved, really smooth, just lying on its side, you know, where it's falling off some fucking huge mega statue. And they've got all these huge temples that are like 50 foot high, these figures, you know, they're all really intricately carved, fantastic. And you just think, fucking hell, how did people do that? And made out of granite and really hard materials, you know, it's not just chipped out of sandstone or something. It's like made out of really hard materials, and it's still standing there. And all these paintings are still, they're still alive. You can still see all the colours really brilliantly inside the tombs and everywhere. You know, see all these temples, all these fantastic paintings all over them. I just think, fucking hell. You know, it's just like mind-boggling, really, because it's all still there, and it's several thousand years old.
So, right.
And, you know, you just get all these ideas about intellectual, intergalactic travel. And, you know, I just finished reading 2001 Space Odyssey, Stanley Clarke. Well, I read it. I don't think I ever read it before. I saw the film and I just finished reading it. It's quite fascinating. You know, and I've always been into sort of extraterrestrial sort of things. You know, I've been really interested in. I sort of spent a lot of time with Steve Hillage. I roped him in to produce my album, this album about Egypt. And while I was with him, I spent quite a lot of time with him. We used to go up to Warminster and look for UFOs, stuff like that.
Or not
all.
Oh, all the kind of things you've been through and everything else, you know, that you're still kind of doing it. Has there ever been a person you've met that you really wanted to meet and you've had the chance to meet them?
Well, I met Timothy Leary. I thought he was quite
interesting. Yeah, Timothy Leary.
Yeah. Yeah, well, yeah. I visited him in Vacaville Psychiatric Prison.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
I thought he was, you know, I was quite impressed by him, really.
Yeah.
I'd read his books and I just was sort of, you know, thought he was quite a knowledgeable and somebody I respected, really. So that was quite cool.
Well, what I was going to ask you. On my magic paper.
Yeah.
Right?
So what I was going to say, Ian, was if there was any band you'd really like to be a part of, what would that be?
I think, Nick, now you ask me that, I think I'd have to say that, do you know, I've always, do you know, Bananarama, you know, Spandau Ballet.
They've got nice bottoms and nice tights.
There you go, Nick Turner asks Ian a question. Fantastic. The world is changing, my friends. And no, if there was, you were saying there, if there was like kind of one part of a band or something you could have been part of.
Well, as I say, I was really quite inspired by Miles Davis and also Jimi Hendrix.
Okay.
And, you know, they're people that I mean, it's not that, and I'm really impressed with John Coltrane. You know?
Okay, yes.
I'd really like to have been part of that whole movement if I could. But I'm not black, they're all black. I don't think they'll hold it against me, because they've always got on really well with mixed race or coloured people.
Yeah.
And I've got a lot of them in my family.
Okay.
You know, I've got about 20 cousins that are all black. You know, that live in Jamaica, and I've got my son-in-law is mixed race, and my girlfriend's half Indian, and you know, I've got a lot of that sort of thing going on, and I've got a lot of friends from Africa that I play with quite frequently. So.
Very worldwide.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Very worldwide.
So I'm probably more impressed with music that has influenced me, and I've been influenced by. Charlie Parker, I really was a great fan of his. I'd like to have been in his band. But it's sort of purely, they're extremely technical and I aspire to be able to express myself in those sort of terms, which I would like to have done, but I don't practice enough. John Coltrane used to practice for 12 hours a day. He'd practice for 12 hours a day. People would come around and see him and say, oh, hi, man, make yourself a cup of coffee. And they'd just sit there looking at him, you know. And he'd be carrying on playing. And he'd say, oh, I've got a gig to go to. Picks up his saxophone, gets in the van, plays all the way to the gig, and he's sitting in the dressing room, and he's just practicing and doing his scales in the dressing room. And then and he goes on the stage and plays My Favourite Things for 2 hours. And he comes off the stage, and he's going, he's still playing, you know. And he gets in the van to go home and he's still playing, and then he gets home and he's still playing, and then he gets into bed and he's still playing, and then he falls asleep with his saxophone on top of him.